Want to be happy? Build a life, not just a business. Hey, it's Evan Carmichael, and this channel was created to help you overcome the number one challenge that is holding you back, a lack of belief in yourself. You watch these videos because you know you've got something more inside you too. You have Michael Jordan level talent at something. So today, let's live your best belief life and learn the habits and routines to get mentally tough. Enjoy. Okay, let's kick it off with habit number one. Visualize daily with Brendan Burchard.
Be honest, is there anything in the last, let's say, 6 months that you had as a goal and then you literally just forgot about? You're like, oh, I forgot I was trying to lose that weight. Yes, please bring the chow mein, right? You just forgot and you didn't mean to forget. See, most people think it's, well, maybe I didn't really want it, or maybe it's a prioritization thing. I'm like, no, it's just that sometimes when we lose touch with what we want because we're not putting it in front of us often enough, we move on to the next thing that's, you know, a fire drill or a challenge or trouble, and the good things that we wanted, the great goals that we set up, fall by the wayside. So how can you prevent that? Bring back your visualization practice. You know, when you first had that goal or that dream, that big desire, like, I bet you sat in bed and you thought about it and you dreamed about it and you could practically taste it. You wanted it so bad. You know, you could see it in your dreams during the day. If you talked to other people about it, it felt real. It was a goal you were going to go after. And it showed up in your dreams. It showed up when you closed your eyes. It showed up when you talked to other people. That's a real fire goal. That's a good one, right? And yet what happens when people often set a goal, they open up their calendar, they schedule it, or they open up a work plan and they say, okay, to achieve goal, I must, you know, measure it this way and I must set this date and I must do all these things. And they tactically fill out their calendar or fill up their day planner, and it sounds like it's gonna happen, right? But it doesn't. It's because, look, you could have lots of to-dos all over your calendar, but never feel like really going for the goal. And that's because you're not emotionally charging yourself up for that goal on a continual basis. That's why it falls aside so quickly. Because you got really excited about it, but then, oh, this other thing I'm excited about. And this other thing I'm excited about. And now you're just running around like you've got like super massive ADD, which I totally understand. So here's what you have to do. Here's what you have to do. You have to set up a visualization practice that is daily. Here's the simplest technique for you if you're not already doing it. When you wake up in the morning, each morning, before you even get out of bed, just wake up, and as soon as you wake, take a nice couple deep breaths, close your eyes, and visualize yourself striving for your goals, struggling for your goals, then attaining your goals, okay? So what I mean, literally, imagine, like, for me, I'm an author, as you know, right? I write books. So I'll sit there and I'll think, okay, I can see myself writing at the desk today. Okay, now, oh, I see myself not writing at the desk today, the struggle. I've gone off and I'm wandering around the park convincing myself that this is what I must do to find some creativity. Stop that, no. The most important part about visualization is not to see yourself cross the finish line. It's to see what do you do when the struggle happens to maintain, right? So if you want to run a marathon, as an example, lots of people say, well, visualize yourself running across the marathon line. Visualize that, visualize that, visualize that. I'm like, actually, no. Visualize yourself getting up for months and months and months, going for those morning runs, practicing. Visualize yourself when you are running the marathon, right in the middle of the marathon, when you're at, let's say you're at like mile 13, you know, and you're just like, oh my gosh, I can't possibly do anymore. Visualize yourself overcoming that struggle. That's where an emotional sort of anchor sets in for making a goal important. When not only do you visualize yourself doing it, but struggling through to make it happen. Then yes, visualize yourself running across that finish line. I visualize myself opening up that box of books when my publisher first sends me the first draft, finally manuscript, finally published. When I open up that box and I get that first book and I'm like, this is real. You know, that's my moment, like it's real. So I'll lay in bed visualizing that. Not kidding. And I don't do it once, not twice, not three times. I've been doing that visualization technique for the last 6 months as I'm trying to finish my next book. So I'm not just talking about this conceptual. I do this in my own life. And I encourage you to do that. If you keep having goals that fall off onto the wayside or fall on the back burner, it's because you're not revisiting them. You need to revisit it, visualize it, See it, right? Really make it a visual thing. Tell the story, see it in your mind.
Habit number two, avoid the backpack mentality with Eric Thomas.
What's the backpack mentality? You remember when you were in class, the last 10 minutes of class before the bell rings, man, you already packing your stuff in the backpack. You already got your backpack on and you ready to go. You say, what do you mean, E.T.? You're ready to go before you even got the information. Listen to me, in some classes, you gotta be careful because the teacher don't really start giving out the gems. They don't really start giving out the real information to win, the very end. And some of you have already packed your bags. You're like, it's Christmas time. It's December. I can go into cruise control, and I'm here to tell you that your boy E.T. been grinding in December. That's right. I got more gigs in December than I got in September and October and November. I got more calls in December. I'm doing photo shoots, baby. That's right. Me and my boy CJ sat down, and we spent the whole Sunday putting together our professional development. You said, E.T., what professional development? That's what I'm trying to tell you. We don't even have any calls right now to do professional development in January. Or February, but guess what we're doing? We preparing in December for what's going to eventually come in January, February, March, or April. So we not waiting for it to come to us. We going to get it. So principle number one, man, you got to get out of that backpack mentality. Like, you got to stop quitting. You got to stop giving up, right, and doing something new when you didn't finish doing what you're supposed to do. Now, I know this ain't y'all experience, but I got a lot of friends, bro, who doing network marketing, right? And it's crazy. Like, they weren't successful in their last job. That's why they doing network marketing, many of them, not because they love it, because they have a passion for it. They trying to make money, right? They trying to make money in something new when they weren't making money in what they were doing before. And they think that E.T., the hip-hop preacher, you know, okay, E., I need two people to help me. And if you can get two people, that's four people. Listen to what I'm trying to tell you. I don't have nothing against network marketing. And I think for those people who are serious about it, they gonna blow up. But there are some people, you leave one thing and you go to the next thing. You got the backpack mentality. You trying to pack up. You trying to do new stuff when you haven't finished doing what you were supposed to do before. You haven't even seen the class all the way through. And you missed some very good principles. You missed some very good gems. Why? Because you're giving up. You pack. You know what's so funny? I remember when I used to pack my bags when I had the backpack mentality. I used to pack my bags, right? I was late for the next class. That's right. It wasn't even like I packed my stuff up and I was ready for the next class. I would be late for the next class. Why? Because I wasn't in school to learn. I wasn't in school to learn. And many of you, you're not in life to learn. Like, you keep thinking that you're gonna blow up financially. You keep thinking that your life is gonna change, that you're gonna have what you never had, and you're gonna be what you never was, and you're gonna do what you've never done before. But the reality is this. The reality is, if you give up too soon, if you don't learn all the lessons that you're supposed to learn, you're gonna keep going in circles in life, and you will never get to where you're supposed to get to in life. So do me a favor. Don't pack your bags before it's time. Don't pack your bags before it's time. E.T. ain't chilling. E.T. ain't giving up. E.T. is doing more in December than I did in October, than I did in September, than I did in August, right? This weekend, I'm up at 3:30 in the morning. I'm up at 4 o'clock on Sunday, putting in an hour and a half, hour on the treadmill.
Habit number three, stop making excuses with Dean Graziosi.
Excuses are much deeper and more powerful than you could ever imagine. And why? Is because excuses are comfortable. I don't know if anyone's ever told you that or shared that with you, or if you thought about it in that way, but excuses are comfortable. If you're not making money in real estate right now, it might be because maybe your area is too busy, or you don't have a lot of money, or you don't have a lot of time, or you have a lot of naysayers in your life. Reality or an excuse? You know, in life, you can have an excuse or you can have an obstacle that's an opportunity to learn, to grow, right? So here's what I want to talk about today. I want to challenge you this week to really observe the thoughts that you have and the things that you say out loud. And I'd love for you to mark down the ones that maybe could be considered an excuse. I mean, I've been around people my whole life who say they want more. They want a fulfilled life. They want to wake up with fully being successful and grateful and gratitude. But unfortunately, life teaches us to fill the places that we don't push forward through or make happen or reach the level of success we want. And our body creates these excuses. And what I've done recently is I've really looked back in my life. And I think you could probably do the same thing and look back and realize that excuses are something that we're not born with. We don't know these as a child. But what happens is the world delivers them to us. Our parents may have. I love my parents, but our parents may have delivered us excuses. You may have, you know, formed excuses from people, your peers when you were in school, because it's easier. You know, we can't get ahead because we're the lower middle class. We can't get ahead because we're women. We can't get ahead because we don't have money. You know, it's easy to attach a label, and unfortunately, that becomes your comfort food. If I'm not making money in real estate, it's something else's fault. If I just find that, then, it wasn't me. It wasn't that I didn't overcome the obstacles in my way. It wasn't that I didn't go all the way through my education, or I didn't make that phone call I was supposed to make, or I didn't go look at those houses, or I didn't. It's hard sometimes to look in the mirror and go, the hell with excuses, what am I not doing? What more can I do? That's the questions I'd love for you to ask. Listen, none of this is easy. Life's not easy. But so many people that find an excuse will live that. And the only thing I want to ask is, at the end of our lives, do we want to have a bunch of excuses why we didn't live life fulfilled? Or do we want to be able to look back and say, you know what, I made those tough choices. I looked at myself. I looked deep within myself and realized, the hell with excuses. I slack in this area. I'm a little afraid in this area. I'm scared. I'm a little lazy. I'm hesitant. Whatever it is, who cares? Let's figure it out and let's just get honest. All change starts with honesty. So this week, I encourage you to be honest with yourself. Make a list of those excuses and just write them down and throw them in the garbage. Listen, if you ever quit smoking, you quit like that. Quit drinking, you quit like that. Quit being negative because you watch my blogs, that would be such a blessing and I'd appreciate that. You quit just like that. How about we just quit excuses? Like quitting a bad habit, let's just quit excuses and give it a shot this week.
Habit number four, put in the work with Mel Robbins.
I have a question. Are you frustrated because you haven't made it yet? Be honest. You start to think, I'm never gonna find the time to make it happen. You'll never be talented enough. You could never be that funny, smart, or innovative, right? The truth is, a million likes online doesn't mean anything until you like yourself. $1 million in the bank ain't worth nothing if you've got no self-worth. So before you give up, you have to understand the only thing that matters is the work that you're putting in, not the end result. And if your social media feeds are bringing you down, just remember, you're only seeing the end game. Anyone who is truly successful did one thing, and it's the same thing that we all do. They put in the work. And that work is what you don't see online. Every single day you make choices. You choose to drive or you choose to slide into the passenger seat of life. Which is it gonna be? The thoughts you allow yourself to spend time on determine if you get what you want, because your dreams matter, but you're the one who's gonna have to make them happen. I mean, look at this post from Lin-Manuel Miranda, the creator of Hamilton. This was 3 years before Hamilton hit Broadway and he was ready to give up. Ed Sheeran, he was working on his dreams way before he was a Grammy Award winning artist. Are you working? If you're not working, are you waiting for permission? Stop. You don't need permission. You just need to push yourself to take that first step and then to keep going. Will you fail along the way? Of course. And you know what? I hope so. And here's why. A study of entrepreneurs found that when you fail once, you double your chances of success. Failure doesn't make you give up. Failure happens when you give up. Those of you who succeed are the ones who get back up over and over and over again. Wait, what did you say? You're afraid of judgment? Of people criticizing you? Welcome to the Success Club. You don't belong if you don't have haters. Lady Gaga had so many people who doubted her that they formed online groups around the topic of her failure. It's a great sign when you have critics because it's life testing. How bad do you want it? Instead of thinking game over, how about thinking game on? Don't wait to feel ready because that's not gonna happen. The bottom line, it's keep going. Keep going because no one is coming to save you. No one is coming to do the work for you. No one is coming to walk over and turn off Netflix. No one is coming to tell you to get out the door and go on a run. No one is coming to tell you to pick up the phone and make the phone call. It's up to you, and it's always going to be up to you. And whether you succeed or whether or not you fail is up to you. Your dreams they don't expire. And that's why every single day you gotta wake up and you gotta renew your commitment to that dream by trying one more time every single day.
Also, to make sure you're actually taking action after watching this video, I've designed a special free worksheet just for this video. The worksheet will highlight all of the lessons learned in this video, as well as pull out our three favorite learnings and quotes that will inspire you to actually do something. The worksheet will also give you space to write down what your key takeaways are and your specific plan of action to make sure you're getting results. If you want the worksheet designed specifically for this video, absolutely for free, there's a link in the description below. Go click on it and start building the momentum in your life and your business. I'll see you there. Habit number 5, pursue consistently with David Meltzer.
Time does not align with that thought, right? Time is a scarcity. Right, if we think in terms of time, a man-made construct, by the way, we only have so much time. Oh, I'll be happy when I graduate. I'll be happy when I get my first job. I'll be happy when I make $100,000. I'll be happy when I make $1 million. I'll be happy when I make $100 million. I'll be happy when I get married. I'll be happy when I get divorced. I'll be happy, right? It goes on and on. And guess what? When you attach your happiness to an outcome based on time, that time will never come. You need to, in order to be happy, enjoy the consistent every day, persistent without quit, pursuit of your potential. That's happiness. Enjoy the consistent, persistent pursuit of your potential. And you gotta know what your potential is. What do you want? Right? What is it? You wanna be a sports journalist? You wanna be a sports doctor? You wanna be a sports lawyer? You wanna be a, what is it you wanna be? Administrator? You wanna be an athlete? Whatever it is you want, you need to consistently, every day, persistently, without quit, enjoy that pursuit. Why consistency? I think consistency is the most important thing because consistency elevates your awareness. What's the lesson? Don't limit your point of entry. Consistently, persistently pursue your potential and enjoy it. That's all I did. I didn't let anything limit me. All I kept doing was thinking about what I wanted, why I wanted it, and how I was gonna get it, and trusted the universe. This is what most people do. They're afraid of heights. So what do? They go, I'm afraid of heights, and they focus in on being afraid, and they focus in on being afraid, and they keep focusing on being afraid. And then what happens? They get real close to what they're afraid of, and of course what happens? They fall off. Why? Because they're afraid of heights. And then, of course, they catch and they save themselves on some branch. And they're hanging there. They're hanging there. And they're thinking, oh my God, is anybody up there that can help me? Now they're asking for inspiration. Now they're asking for help. When they put all their faith in what they didn't want and they were surprised to get what they didn't want because they put faith in what they didn't want and they're hanging there and they're looking up going, anyone there to help you? And then the universe or God comes down and says, yes, I am here to help you. Just let go. I'll catch you. I'll catch you. But you know what? We're all too afraid. We're all too afraid to let go. So what do? We look back up and say, anyone else up there that can help me? Come on. I let go. I let go. I didn't trust. I wasn't afraid to say, oh, if I don't become a real lawyer, I'll never be a sports agent. Oh, if I don't take that normal job. Oh, if I didn't do this, I can't help out my friend. Oh, if I don't start meditating, there's no limit in the point of entry, even today from what I did.
Habit number 6, decide to turn around with Grant Cardone. You had a kind of a tough start in life. There was kind of drugs, there was job losses, a lot of kind of things happened to you. What was that trigger that made you say enough was enough? I want to turn this around.
Yeah, well, there was, you know, I just hated my life, man. I hated my life. I hated that I was a disappointment to myself, my family, my community. I knew it. They knew it. And look at myself in the mirror. I was praying, meditating, begging, and I just kept making the wrong moves. At some point, you know, when you try and you don't quit enough times, sooner or later it's going to click. So I had a drug problem from the age of 15 to 25. And it was awful, dude. It was I was a degraded, beat up, physically depleted, spiritually depleted, financially bankrupt individual. And, you know, I was a disappointment to my family, but mostly myself. And every day I got up and said, hey, I'm going to quit today. I'm not going to do it. Today is the last day. And the drugs were really not the problem. Now that I look back, I mean, drugs were a problem for me, but the real problem was I was bored. I was stuck in schools for 17 years where I wasn't moving fast enough. I didn't understand why I was doing what I was doing. I've always wanted to be successful. I had these ideas when I was a kid that I was going to be famous and I was going to be a writer when I was 8 years old, and that one day I'd be rich because my dad, it was really important to my dad to take care of the family. I came from a great household and I just screwed it all up. And it all got confusing while I was going to school because I was like, I don't know why I'm going here. What am I doing? And then when I was 25, I finally quit using drugs. And after a big battle with trying to get off of that, and then dedicated all that destructive energy into turning my life around. I've spent the last 37 years, including today, trying to become a better person and trying to learn and studying the successes of others in order for me to figure out how can I
way. Habit number 7, stick around with Ed Mylett.
I believe the greatest talent that you can draw a line through all the people who have won, not all the people that win in business or life are unbelievable transfers of energy. Not all of them can close. Not all of them can persuade. Not all of them are great listeners. Not all of them even dealt well with adversity. They did that the majority of the time. But all of them have in common, they developed the talent, and yes, it is a talent. It is a skill of not quitting. I don't think most of you right now that are struggling in your business life right now are giving yourself enough credit for this incredible talent you're developing, which is resiliency, which is the ability not to quit. Listen to what I'm telling you. As somebody has built multiple different companies, I've coached some of the top athletes, entertainers, business people, and politicians in the world. And I'm telling you that even in my own team when I hire people, I look for resiliency, and a notch above that is the talent, is the skill of not quitting as the number one thing that I look for. And many of you right now listening to this possess the number one skill necessary to win and don't give yourself any credit for it, which means it's not helping build your confidence. It's not going to the bank of crediting for your identity. And so although you possess this incredible ability that so many people in the world don't have and don't possess, you have it and you don't value it. You don't prize it. You don't give yourself credit for having it. It ought to be where you draw the majority of your confidence from. The ability to say, I don't quit. I'm resilient. I own the number one skill, the number one talent required to eventually win. I already have. I can't quit. You'd have to kill me to get me out of chasing my dream, right? So number one, I want to point it out as the number one gift. The best ability is availability. Do you have it? Have you decided to have it? Is it something you're going to possess the rest of your life? And those of you that do have it already, I need you to take an inventory, be aware of it, and be intentional with crediting yourself as you're listening to this or watching it today into the bank of your self-confidence, into the bank, into the deposits you make in your identity, because it has everything to do with winning. Every guest you've seen on my show, all the people that I've coached, all have different talents, skills, and abilities. What's the one they all have? The ability to stay present, the ability to stay in the fight, to have not quit. You think, well, that's not a big deal. Really? Because as I've been talking, millions of people made the decision to quit on their dream, just as I've been talking to you. The rest of the day, millions more will. Tomorrow, millions more. Every day, literally millions of people quit on one of their dreams, their dream relationship, their dream business, their dream body. So quitting has become the number one habit in the world by people that end up losing. And I'm telling you, it happens every day, every second, everywhere. Just the fact that while I've been speaking, you're still after your dream. You're ahead of them. You don't give yourself enough credit. Because eventually what I found, it looks like winning's this huge competition. But every day, every week, every year, every decade, as time goes by, you're going to find that you're competing with a smaller and smaller and smaller group of people for your dream. Because so many of them will just quit. And by the way, many of them that quit will possess talents, maybe even gifts you don't have. Their incredible ability with people, their incredible strength, their incredible brain. and they'll quit with all this giftedness, but you got the talent. You have to learn to distinguish between something that is a talent and a gift. You can develop skills, you can develop talents. Gifts are something you're born with, but the people that I see that win long-term are the ones who develop the talents and skills required to win. Business and life's a lot like a pinata. You know, I was at a barbecue, a birthday party for a five-year-old a while back, and they did a pinata. I mean, you've seen the pinata before. And it's an unbelievable metaphor for life. In fact, we ought to call today, the life is like a pinata. Because it really is. If you look at these kids at these parties, any of you that ever been to a pinata, you can picture it. They got the pinata up there, and what do? It's just like in business and life, when you start something new, a new relationship, a new body, a new pursuit, a new business, right? What do? They take this little five-year-old and they blindfold him. They blindfold this little guy, right? And he can't see. He doesn't know where he's going. And then they spin him around. He gets completely disoriented. Right? And then they hand him a bat. It's scary when you watch it, don't you? Picture these little kids, right? You blindfold them. They spin them around. They become disoriented. Does that sound familiar to any of you that are trying to build a business right now? You're completely disoriented. You're blind. You don't know where to go. They spin this little guy around. They hand him a bat and they go, hit the pinata. And the pinata's over to the right and they're swinging to the left. They're just whiffing, right? They're not even in the right direction. And then finally, what do? You grab the little guy or the little girl and you turn them and you have them face the pinata. They were completely disoriented. In fact, they were doing more damage to the people around them in the beginning with that darn bat you gave them because they're so disoriented. A lot of damage was done before they even faced the actual pinata. They've been blindfolded and spun around, right? They're completely disoriented. Doesn't that sound familiar? What happens is sometimes the first few kids who hit the pinata, they kind of disappear from the party and start playing somewhere else. Maybe you've had that experience in your business. Some of the people you start with, they may not finish before the candy comes out. They may not be there. May not be there to celebrate, right? Some of the initial people disappear, and that could cause you to want to quit. But eventually what happens with that pinata, even though these kids are hitting the pinata and they're teaming up, they're all working together to try to make this candy come out, it doesn't look like it, but each shot on that pinata is putting them closer to the candy. Even though it doesn't seem like it, even though you can't see the candy, every blow is like a compound pounding effect. That pounding, compounded by multiple people, eventually can create a breakthrough. But what most people do is they leave the party before the candy comes out. That's true in business. Most people quit before the candy comes out. They don't stick around long enough. They got spun around. They get disoriented. They might hurt the people around them. They get pointed in the right direction. They think they're making progress. Then they don't. And they think they're making progress. Then they don't. And eventually, because no candy's coming out, no money, no changed body, no amazing relationship, they stop swinging the bat at the pinata. But if you stick around for the party long enough, you know what always happens with a pinata? Eventually someone hits it and bam, the candy comes out everywhere and everyone celebrates and gets all the candy and dives on it and celebrates. Here's what I'm here to remind you of today. You got to stick around long enough for the candy to come out. You got to wait for the candy to come out of that pinata called your life, called your business, called your body, called your relationships. The vast majority of people in life don't stick around for the candy because they think as they're hitting the pinata of their life, they don't think they're making progress. It doesn't feel like progress. But I'm telling you, the number one ability is availability. And if you keep swinging away every day, even though it doesn't feel like it, you are getting closer to the candy. You're getting closer. It just doesn't feel like it. You know what I had? I had the ability to keep hitting the pinata in my life, to stick around long enough. And by the way, when you eventually win, it's not just you that gets all the candy, that gets all the victory, that gets all the money. Lots of people around you, many of which who you were hurting originally with that bat, many of them who were trying to talk you out of it, they get to celebrate in the candy too.
Habit number 8, have the guts to fail with Denzel Washington.
You will fail at some point in your life. Accept it. You will lose. You will embarrass yourself. You will suck at something. There's no doubt about it. And I know that's probably not a traditional message for a graduation ceremony, but hey, I'm telling you, embrace it because it's inevitable. And I should know. In the acting business, you fail all the time. Early on in my career, I auditioned for a part in a Broadway musical. Perfect role for me, I thought, except for the fact that I can't sing. So I'm in the wings, I'm about to go on stage, but the guy in front of me, he's singing like Pavarotti. He's just on and on and on, and he's just going on and on and on. And I'm just shrinking. I'm getting smaller and smaller. So they say, oh, thank you very much, thank you very much, and you'll be hearing from us. So I come out with my little sheet music, and it was just my imagination by the Temptations. That's what I came up with. So I hand it to the accompanist, and she looks at it and looks at me and looks out at the director and was like, right. So I start, you know, I'm going to sing. I'm like, it's just my imagination. Once again, and then coming away with me. And I'm not saying anything, so I'm thinking I'm getting better. So I just start getting into it. It was just my imagination. Running. They say, oh, yeah, thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Washington. Thank you. So I assumed I didn't get the job. But the next part of the audition, he called me back. The next part of the audition is the acting part of the audition. Now I'm like, hey, okay, maybe I can't sing, but I know I can act. So they pair me with this guy. And again, I didn't know about musical theater. And musical theater is big, so they can reach everyone all the way in the back of the stadium. And I'm more from a realistic, naturalistic kind of acting where you actually talk to the person next to you. So I don't know what my line was. My line was, well, hand me the cup. And his line was, well, I will hand you the cup, my dear. The cup will be there to be handed to you. And I said, oh, okay. Well, should I give you the cup back? Oh, yes, you should give it back to me because you know that is my cup and it should be given back to me. I didn't get the job. But here's the thing. I didn't quit. I didn't fall back. I walked out of there to prepare for the next audition and the next audition and the next audition. I prayed. But I continued to fail and fail and fail. But it didn't matter because you know what? There's an old saying, you hang around the barbershop long enough, sooner or later you're going to get a haircut. So you will catch a break, and I did catch a break. Last year, I did a play called Fences on Broadway. Someone talked about it. Won the Tony Award. And I didn't have to sing, by the way. But here's the kicker. It was at the Court Theater. It was at the same theater that I failed that first audition 30 years prior. The point is, and I'll pick up the pace. The point is, every graduate here today has the training and the talent to succeed. But do you have the guts to fail? Here's my second point about failure. If you don't fail, you're not even trying. I'll say it again. If you don't fail, you're not even trying. My wife told me this great expression. To get something you never had, you have to do something you never did. Les Brown's a motivational speaker. He made an analogy about this. He says, imagine you're on your deathbed, and standing around your deathbed are the ghosts representing your unfulfilled potential, the ghost of the ideas you never acted on, the ghost of the talents you didn't use. And they're standing around your bed, angry, disappointed, and upset. They say, we came to you because you could have brought us to life, they say. And now we have to go to the grave together. So I ask you today, how many ghosts are going to be around your bed when your time comes?
Habit number 9, kill the quitter instincts with Jocko Willink.
There's another kind of instinct that you need to be on the lookout for. And this one is a liar. This one is a saboteur. This one is a backbiter. And like the devil himself, he's a shapeshifter. He He's going to disguise himself and make you think he's got your best interest in mind. But he doesn't. This is the instinct that says, you've had enough. This is the instinct that says, you've given it your best shot. You can stand down. You can back off. You can take a knee. This is the instinct that says, you can rest now. Do not listen to that instinct. Do not listen. That instinct is a liar and wants to bring you down. That's the instinct that's a defense mechanism. It wants to give you an out, a place to run to, a little place of sympathy, an amnesty, a little place of amnesty where everything is forgiven, where all these failures can gather together in comfort and drown their sorrows in lies and in deception. And they tell each other, and they'll tell you, you did the best you could. No, they'll say the deck was stacked against you. And they'll say, it's not your fault. And they'll tell you, it's okay to stop. It's okay to settle. It's okay to give up. And that is the instinct you need to fight. You need to push back, to smash into the ground. Do not take the easy way out. Do not give up based on instinct. If you are forced to stand down, to retreat, so that you can rebuild and reattack, so be it. But make that decision based on logic, not on the instinct of surrender and defeat. And you need to train that instinct, your instinct. Train it to say, get up, go, fight on. And if that is what you become, if that becomes your fundamental reaction to adversity, if that becomes your gut instinct, then you will overcome just about anything that stands in your path.
And habit number 10, the last one before some very special bonus clips, is take control of your mind with David Goggins.
I'm the only person in the history of Navy SEAL training to go through 3 Hell Weeks in 1 year.
Can you explain a little bit what Hell Week is? Because I heard it on your audiobook a lot.
Yeah,
and it just sounds like a painful moment that very few people are able to handle it.
It is a very long, painful moment. So I don't know what week it is, but for me, it was my 3rd week. Mm-hmm. And sometimes it's your 3rd, 4th, or 5th week in Navy SEAL training. Navy SEAL training is 6 months long. And this is like the biggest crucible in Navy SEAL. It probably in all of Special Forces, you know, Special Ops. It's 130 hours of continuous training. And you might get 2 hours of sleep. And the whole idea is you start on Sunday and you end on Friday. You might get 2 hours of sleep. And the whole idea of this training is to get a man and break him down to nothing. And that's where you see what a man's made of. So to make it through one, most people say, I'm never going back through again. So I was fortunate, God blessed me. So I started looking at these failures as blessings. Because with all these failures and all these bullies and all these being abused and all in my learning disabilities and stuttering and everything I had in my life, they are really gifts.
Yeah.
They're gifts. It's not some psychological babble bullshit that I'm using to say, oh no, my life wasn't that bad. No, my life sucked. But they truly were gifts because all these different trials and tribulations led my mind to where it's at now. So Hell Week, once again, 130 hours. You get 2 hours of sleep maybe, and they beat the shit out of you. Beating like push-ups, sit-ups. And it's near the Pacific Ocean. So you're out in the Pacific Ocean back in, and that water's freezing. And so you see these men, these great men that I watched on TV, I'm now with them. And for the longest time, I put people who had better childhoods, better grades, better this, better that, I put them all above me. But now I'm on the same playing field as them. So when you get on the same playing field as these men who you think are better than you, you look at them eye to eye, mm-hmm. and you realize that they're not. So once again, I'm starting to do all this live autopsy shit, like saying, God, man, you were mind-f***ing yourself your whole life, thinking that this person came from a nicer house, better education, better mom, better dad, and they're better than you. It's not the case. You have this in you. You may have to dig a little deeper to find it. You know, their family may have started them off a lot better than you, mm-hmm. but it's there.
Yeah.
It's there. So I started really realizing how powerful the mind was in that third Hell Week. So I went down to the gym, and there's this like crazy elliptical trainer, but it's not a normal elliptical trainer. It's one that you like almost self-power. It's very...
Yeah, it's not electric. You do it.
Very difficult.
Yeah.
So I got on that thing, and I realized, man, this sucks. And after like 2 minutes, I'm like, I don't want to do this. So right then I realized, it looks like we're going to be here for a while. So I did that for 2 hours and 45 minutes.
Wow.
Yeah. So I'm not saying do that, but that's something I did today. Once my mind said, you know what, let's not do this today. I said, well, since my mind went there, I redirected it and said, just for having that weak thought, we're going to be on here for a while.
Right. So it does sort of sound like you're punishing part of your mind in a way.
Punishment, maybe not be the right word.
Yeah.
I want my mind to know who's in charge. So for the better part of 26 years, my mind was in charge of me.
Yeah.
Which is why I made all these horrible decisions. Once you take control of your mind, you start making decisions for yourself versus your mind making decisions for you.
So I love the story of Colonel Sanders. He's one of my favorite stories and examples to give of an older entrepreneur. This guy didn't really start franchising his business, KFC, until he was in his 60s and didn't really become an icon or someone super well known until he was in his 70s. How many people quit too soon on their business? I can't tell you how many people come up to me and say, Evan, I'm 25 years old. Is it too late to get started? Like, what are you talking about? And really just comes down to just your belief system. Here was a guy who was 62 years old when he was franchising KFC, where a lot of people would be saying, I'm getting ready to retire. I'm getting ready to slow down. I'm getting ready to wind things up, you know, just ease into the rest of my life. And it was a guy who said, no, I'm gonna crush it. I'm just getting started. I want to build an empire, right? And this really comes down to whether you believe it can happen or it can happen. You're right. If you believe at 62 years old that you're too old to get started on something new, then you're right and you won't take action. But if you believe that age is just a number and 62 means you've got lots of experience and you're ready to go crush some new project, then you're right as well. And so you have to be really careful to pay attention to the story that you're telling yourself, because a lot of times we're holding ourselves back with these excuses of we're too old, we're too young, we come from the wrong country, we don't have the right education, you don't have the right parents, on and on and on. And as long as you believe that reinforcing story, then it's going to continue to perpetuate. Now, in terms of don't quitting, there's a lot of advice in don't quit, don't quit, don't quit, don't quit. You should not quit when it's your dream. When this is something that you really, 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 really want to do, then you can't quit on it. But if it's something that you've lost the passion for, you don't feel energized by it anymore, it feels like work to show up, then that's when you quit. And so when people ask me, should I quit this thing or not? Well, is it still your dream? Are you still passionate about it? Are you still excited about it? Because if you are, then you enjoy the process. And yes, you want to get the results. And yes, you want to win. And yes, you want to make the money. And yes, you want to have that impact. But you still enjoy the process. I like making YouTube videos. This is fun for me. It's enjoyable for me. I'm growing through it. And even if I wasn't on the path to hitting a million subscribers, I would still be doing it because I love doing it. And if I was on the path to hitting a million subscribers and I stopped liking it, then I would leave. I would sell it. I would go do something else, because you cannot do great things when you don't love what you do. And so as long as it's still your passion, as long as it's still your dream, you have to keep going, or you're going to live the rest of your life in regret. But if you've lost that passion, then get out immediately and go do something else that does bring you excitement, joy, energy, and fulfillment.
If you quit on something too soon that you still love, you will regret it for the rest of your life. If you don't love it anymore, quit. Move on. You will never win doing work that you hate. But if you love it, you love it, and you move on to something else, you will look back on this day and regret it for the rest of your life that you did not see it through. Most people spend their entire life living with regrets. Don't let that be you. The hardest decision I ever had to make in my life was being an entrepreneur. I struggled a lot with the decision, do I want to be an entrepreneur, and had this opportunity to make $300 a month and earn 30% of a company versus going to work at a job that I thought I wanted, a job that I'd been preparing myself for, that this is what I wanted to do. It was in my high school yearbook of this is where I was going to be. And here it was, earning six figures, traveling around the world, doing the investment banking that I thought I wanted to do versus making $300 a month and owning 30% of a company. And the thing that allowed me to push through and be an entrepreneur was me saying, I don't want to live with regret. That I would rather no one fail than not know. And I gave myself a year. I said, I'm going to give myself a year to do this. I could always go back and get another job. It may not be the same job. It probably wouldn't be the same job. It may not be as much pay. It may not be traveling as much as this job was offering me to travel. But this entrepreneurial thing, this opportunity that I had, I never knew if it would come back again. Like, I thought maybe this will never happen to me again. And so I decided to go for it. And we struggled and it was hard, but I never ended up having to go back and get another job. And so if you're at an inflection point, if you're thinking about which path should I take, A or B, lean in with your heart. Stop using your head. Your head only understands the world that currently exists. Lean in with your heart and ask yourself, which decision will I regret more if I don't do? And then go take that action. I became an entrepreneur because I didn't want to regret not having at least tried. And a great moment in my life came a number of years later, where one of the people I went to university with came back and said, Evan, I went down that path. I became the investment banker and I hate my life. How do I become an entrepreneur? And I looked in his eyes and I saw the desperation and the sadness and helped him, but also was so grateful that that wasn't me, because it could have been.
If you want to know the simple trick to help you persevere, check out the video right there next to me. I think you'll love it. Continue to believe, and I'll see you there.
So my self-talk is me reminiscing back on the struggle to get to this moment. Your mind has a tactical advantage over you at all times. It knows your weaknesses, it knows your strengths, and it will guide you.